Well, good afternoon. How's everyone enjoyed TechEd this year? Pretty good? This is something I've never been able to say. This is the last session of this TechEd. Normally, Mark Rusinovich gets to say, this is the final session, but he was my opening act today. Thought he did pretty well for an opening act. My name is Aaron Margosis. I'm going to be touching on a lot of the same things he was talking about, but I'm going to be covering it in a different manner. This is the Sysinternals Primer, TechEd 2013 edition. And it is based on this book, the Windows Sysinternals Administrator's Reference, which came out about 2 years ago, right after TechEd 2011. If you're interested in using the Sysinternals tools, there is no more accurate and complete reference to all the tools, how to use them, what the different, what the data that it's telling you means, and how to make use of it. It took about 2 years to produce this book, which was a lot longer than we expected. We also blew through the anticipated page count, so it became a much bigger book because we wanted to make it as accurate and complete and useful as possible. And based on all the feedback we've gotten, I think we exceeded expectations there. It is written by, as you can see, Mark Rusinovich and Aaron Margosis. Mark actually wanted my name to be smaller than this on the cover. And MS Press said, no, we can't do that, because if we do, then we have to ship a magnifying glass with every copy, and that'll raise the cost too much. So this was the compromise. The Sysinternals Primer series is something that we've been doing for a few years. I've had some co-presenters along the way. I'm doing this one solo. The idea behind the Sysinternals Primer was, how many of you have been to Case of the Unexplained? I'm sure most of you have seen at least one. And that sets up a lot of stories of here is the problem that came up and how we went about solving it. We had there's a technical account manager named Tim Reckmeyer at Microsoft who had the idea, how about something that just focuses on the tools and dives into the details of the tools and tries to tell as much about the tools as possible without all the other stuff. And this is what we've been doing for the last several years. So as you can see, TechEd 2010, we covered three of the largest, most popular tools, Process Explorer, Process Monitor, and PS Exec. 2011, we went down to the next level. And then last year, we created something called Gems, where we dove into some of the least known tools and also used it as an excuse to poke around some areas of the operating system that are good to know about, but that are largely misunderstood or not known about at all. So this year, it's going to be what is new and updated since the book came out. Because it's been 2 years, Mark has continued to release new features in the tools and even a couple of new tools. And so that's what we're going to be covering today. One thing that is new since the English language version came out and took us by surprise was a Russian language version of the book. We didn't know this was happening, but we were quite pleased about it. You can tell here that Mark was definitely not aware that this was going to happen. Does anybody see? Font, everybody already knows. That's right. The font sizes are the same on the name. So that never would have happened if, with advanced knowledge about it. Okay, so like I said, the book, when it came out, was accurate and complete. There was really nothing about the tools that was left to say. As time has gone on, and the new features have come out, and the new tools have come out, it's still completely accurate. Everything in there is still true about the tools. The thing is, the new features aren't described in there, so it's no longer complete. So how soon did it start becoming incomplete? Here's the blog post on the Sysinternals blog announcing the release of the book. We are excited and proud to announce the release of the official Sysinternals book. In the same blog post, Process Explorer version 15, this major update to Process Explorer with brand new features that aren't in the book. So that's how long it took. We couldn't even get the book out before Mark was obsoleting it. Okay, so things I'm going to talk about, I'm just going to go through chapter by chapter and talk about new features that are available and things that may be of use to you. A lot of the updates that have continued to come out include bug fixes. I'm not going to talk about any bug fixes, but bug fixes do come out on a regular basis. The tools are continually updated. I highly recommend that you don't have a directory full of Sysinternals tools from 2010 that you just use over and over and over again. Continue to update them because the bug fixes will help solve some problems. We still see, I had this crash, this blue screen because of Procmon driver. It's like, well, that one is really, really old, so you should probably update. One of the things that's been added to a number of the tools is better support for x64. So on 64-bit Windows, 32-bit processors work perfectly fine, right? They just transparently work. However, they get a different view of the system than 64-bit processors. Any 32-bit process that tries to access the system32 folder or anything under it gets redirected transparently to the syswow64 folder. And so some of these tools weren't working correctly because they were operating on different data and different operating system components than the ones that the operating system itself was using. So a program can, if it chooses to, call an API to disable the redirection, registry redirection, as well as file redirection, and then access the actual system32 folder. And that's been done for these tools that are described on the screen. There's also new support for Windows 8 that's been added to a number of these. One of them that I'm not going to talk about beyond this point is Windows 8 has better support for ETW, event tracing for Windows. In Windows 7 and earlier, if you had multiple subscribers, they could collide. Multiple subscribers for a particular event, they could collide with one another, interfere with one another. With Windows 8, if you use the new API calls, you can actually get these things to coexist a lot better. And so where the Sysinternals tools use event tracing for Windows, a number of these tools now have that additional support. In addition, there's things like better support for knowing about file system control codes that are new to Windows 8, the new app container and capability SIDs, and things like that. So commonly asked question, one that came up to me just a few minutes ago, will there be any Sysinternals utilities for Windows RT? So Windows RT is a new version of Windows. It runs on the ARM processor. You cannot run any desktop apps, any Win32 desktop apps on it unless it has been signed by the Windows team. So for example, how many of you have bought a Surface RT? Pretty cool. So you do have desktop there, and there are desktop apps, specifically the Office apps. Those were specifically signed and blessed by the Windows team. They're very tight about enabling anything else to run there, and they're not going to approve any Sysinternals utilities. They say that there is no need for Sysinternals utilities on Windows RT. Why would you need to troubleshoot anything on that platform? It's a really great platform. And that's all I'll say about it because I like remaining employed. So the answer is no, there will be no Sysinternals utilities for Windows RT. Okay, so Process Explorer. Like I said, starting with, as soon as the book came out, version 15 came out, and new features just continue to come out. This is a partial list. I'm not going to go through them one by one. The deck should be on Channel 9 by now, hopefully. If not, it will be within the next some period of time, hopefully in our lifetime. But you can download this and get a hold of this. So instead of going through it item by item, screen dim just as I did that. That was fascinating. Okay, so here is Windows 8, and I'm going to start Process Explorer. And where's my start menu? Let's see. Start menu, Windows R. There we go. Start menu. So the way I always install the Sysinternals utilities is I put them into a new folder. I create a Sysinternals directory under program files and then add that to my path and just update the tools in there. And then I can run the utilities from anywhere. So I'm going to run procexp/e. This is not a new command line switch, but this says run the process with elevated admin rights. And there we go. And as you can see, you know, it's always had the color coding, but the color bands don't go all the way across anymore. There is now this new, the CPU, private bytes, and working set columns now have heat maps, which show you with color, with increasing color, as the resource gets consumed more and more, that something is consuming that resource. So you can see it more quickly than you could before. Let me show an example of that. Here is a little app I wrote to, let's see, let's consume some memory. Scroll down so we can see it. Okay. I'm going to allocate 5 gig of virtual address space. And you can see very quickly through the color, the heat map shows that this is happening. This is only taking up private bytes. It's not actually being read into memory. Let's force those bytes into RAM by reading from them all. And you'll see a couple things. You'll actually see the CPU kick up as well because it's performing a lot of read operations and increasing the amount of memory that's being allocated into the address space and being read into the working set. And brand new this week, if you don't like that, you can turn it off and go back to the old view. I think it's very helpful. I was surprised that he actually turned that off. Another thing we have here is a new color. So all of these are color-coded based on the type of app they are. Is it a service? Is it something running under the same account as Process Explorer? And there's a new one for immersive apps. Let's go over here, launch the camera. Immersive meaning running in the Windows runtime environment, full screen, etc. And that's very interesting, but this showed immersive earlier today when I ran this. This is the webcam process. For some reason, it's not showing as immersive. And now it's showing as suspended. So one of the features of Windows runtime applications, the new immersive apps that are managed by the Process Lifetime Manager, is when they lose focus, they get about 5 seconds to take care of themselves, and then they get suspended. They consume no CPU at all until they get brought back in when they've been granted focus again. And that is to conserve battery power. Because of that, Process Explorer now will say suspended in the CPU column when an app has actually been suspended. One question that came up that I was really curious about is explore.exe is showing as an immersive app. Explore.exe, that, you know, the oldest of desktop applications, it defines the desktop. And yet here is explore.exe appearing as an immersive app. And I asked Mark about it. He didn't know off the top of his head. All he said was there's an API you can call called something like is immersive process or is immersive app that you can ask to say, is this one immersive? And for Explorer, it returns true. I recently found out that screen. What do you suppose is managing this screen? This is explorer.exe running that screen. So it is also an immersive process. Another new feature is you can now, when you create a dump, I'll talk more about dumps later when I talk through process proc dump, but there is an option to create a dump file from process. Why did it do that? There we go. Okay, my system has gotten very confused. Anyway, there is a create dump option similar to what's in Task Manager, except that Process Explorer, when you select a 64-bit dump, it creates, or I'm sorry, when you select a 64-bit process, it'll create a 64-bit dump for that process. If you select a 32-bit process, and this is the new part, instead of creating a 64-bit dump of that 32-bit process, it'll create a 32-bit dump. Because when you're looking at dump files, if it's a 32-bit process, it's a whole lot easier to look at and to analyze if it's a 32-bit dump rather than 64. Another feature I really like is the find dialog. So let me create an excuse here. Let's go to Abby. So the Process Explorer search dialog helps you find DLLs or kernel object handles with a particular name. So you're looking for, I think Mark showed this in the previous session, I've got something keeping this directory open. What is it? And one of the features he added was, you can see here in the results, this thing is really confused. There we go. The type column used to just say handle or DLL. Is it going to appear in the DLL view or the handle view? Now, if it's a handle, a kernel handle, it'll tell you what type of handle. So let me use a better example here. Let's search for Abby. Abby is the username I'm using, and we should see lots of objects with the name Abby. We've got tokens, files, DLLs, and even these synchronization objects that have the user's name as part of it. But you can see in the find dialog now exactly what the file type or what the handle type actually is. So that can save a lot of time. Let's take a look at a lot more data here on the properties dialog of the process. For example, the auto start location, if it is a process that was started or has been configured to start because of some auto start location, it will put that, it'll tell you what that auto start location is and let you jump to that location so that you can find it. So some of the functionality of auto runs is being incorporated in. Another feature here is ASLR. It will tell you whether the file has been compiled and marked to use high entropy ASLR instead of the kind that had been available earlier. Let's find that webcam here. This is an immersive process. It runs inside an app container. And so things we can now see in the security dialog include the capabilities it's been granted, the app container SID. Now this is all a lot of security stuff that has not really been documented yet. The best documentation right now is actually external to Microsoft from people who have reverse engineered this stuff. So we'll see, but whether that's good or not. One of the other things that's been changed here is that these are now sortable columns. So you can sort by what type of group it is in the token. You can sort by group as well, which if you have a number of domains in your forest and you've got a lot of different groups in your token, it's really good to be able to sort by, here's the NT authority ones, here are the built-in ones, and then the different domains that you have in your environment, as well as here are the capability and app container SIDs. This one is not critical, but it's kind of nice. This, if you have services, you can select a service, and if it allows, that one's not marked for that. You can stop, start, restart, pause, and resume services from Process Explorer. Also, the Threads tab, if it is a managed process, a .NET process, it can now show you the call stacks of managed apps, not just native apps. In addition, lots of stuff about the GPU that Mark alluded to earlier. The System Information Dialog has a whole tab dedicated to graphics processing unit, graphs, and statistics. And that is on Vista and newer. And finally, the last thing I'm going to say about Process Explorer. This is the old System Information Dialog. And it had the color scheme, the old clunky color scheme of NT4, you know, with the electric green and the green grid and everything like that. Well, that's so old-fashioned, right? So this is what it looks like now. It is sleek and modern and pastel. How many of you prefer this? Yep. Well, you know, I had a long talk with Mark about this one. And he listened to me very intently for about 15 minutes as I explained all the reasons why the previous version was better than the new version. And he listened, didn't say a thing, and when I was done, he looked at me and said, "Have you gained weight?" But he did say that I could tell you that anyone who doesn't like the new color scheme, you can get your money back. Actually, there is one option in there, one little, I don't know, breadcrumb through us. Configure colors, you can change the graph background. So you can make the graph background black. Yay. I knew I'd get an applause line out of that one. So. Okay. Process Explorer, tons of new stuff in there. Process Monitor has not gotten nearly as many new features, but there are some good ones. And there's a tie-in between this and ProcDump, which I think you're really going to like a lot, which I'll get to when I talk about ProcDump. Mark already talked about some of this. So there's the new bookmark feature where you can just mark an arbitrary event, you know, without having to select specifically, you know, this path equals this or anything like that, just any arbitrary event and bookmark it. For those of you who weren't in the previous session, let me demo that really quickly. That's Procmon. So let's just say that I found that this particular event was of interest to me, and I want to be able to come back to it without, you know, having to figure out what makes this unique that I could set a filter for. Just press Control B. B for bold, B for bookmark, and now if you save this file, it gets remembered as well. And you can navigate between bookmarks, set another bookmark here, with F6 and Shift F6. So if I'm down here and I do Shift F6, it goes back to the previous bookmark, F6 to go forward. In addition, we also have highlighting. Okay, the highlighting is basically the same as it was before. It is now possible, it used to be that if you wanted to navigate from one highlighted event to the next, you open the properties dialog, you can go to the next event by clicking the down arrow now, and you can also click next highlighted, and it'll go down to the next highlighted event. He's also added F4 and Shift F4 to navigate between highlighted events. So quicker navigation. And another one, I really like this one a lot. New feature just came out this week. Let's see. Let's say I want to set a filter on HKEY current user software registered applications. And I right click, I can set an include filter and show only those events, right? That's nothing new. Let's just reset that filter. But a lot of times, I want to set a filter that starts with that, but modify it somehow. So what I'd have to do is set an include filter, then go into the filter dialog and start editing. Brand new feature that just came out this week, right click, edit filter, and that text. So you click that, the filter dialog opens up with path is whatever. So now I can just change that to path contains, or let's say path begins with, and add that. And I get events not just that are equal to that, but that begin with that. And the last thing I'm going to show here is if I create a new process. Reset the filter. This dialog, the process start. The information included in the process start, data that gets captured, includes the environment and the current directory at the time of the process being started. It's incorporated into the process start event. Any questions about any of this so far? Does any of this seem useful at all? I think for what I do every day, this is goldmine stuff. Auto runs. How many of you run auto runs? How many of you have to clean malware off of your relatives' computers? And I saw a lot more hands go up that time. You never use auto runs when you're cleaning malware off of your relatives' computers? This is the most effective tool because, you know, the simple malware especially just hooks into auto start entry points. Auto runs makes it incredibly easy to find them and get rid of them. Anyway, what is new in here? Auto runs has new auto start locations, tons of new places that it looks in the operating system. It has a new feature called jump to image. Fire this thing up. So it was always possible to right click and jump to entry, and it would take you to the location where the auto start entry point was configured. So in this case, I've got Zoomit configured to auto start every time I log on. It's configured in the registry, and this is this helps me find that. There's a new feature called jump to image, which takes you to the location of the executable that's getting started. Okay, that's brand new. The active filter of auto runs is now shown in the status bar. So by default, just Windows entries are hidden. You can change that to hide Microsoft entries and verify code signatures, and that will appear in the status bar as well. There's now also a file association for ARN files. If you save an AutoRuns file to the hard drive, it's a star.arn. Nothing new there. But now AutoRuns creates a file association, so if you double-click on an ARN file, it will open AutoRuns with that file. And finally, AutoRuns C, the command line version, has added switches to support file hashes. And in particular, SHA-256 file hashes, which are what AppLocker uses to identify files by hash. And one other thing about AutoRunC is it also has support for what are the auto start entries of different users. That's been there for a while. It now has a switch that allows you to get the auto start entry points for all users on the computer, the per user entry points of all the users that it can find on the system. PS tools. I'm going to show you something that hasn't been released yet, and if I can get a good applause out of it, maybe Mark will take it and actually release it. PS exec version 2. He needs to go to a new major version because he's at 1.98 right now. There's not a whole lot he can do without running out of space. So the new feature he has added, ordinarily, let me get Process Explorer up here so you can see this. Okay, ordinarily, when Process Explorer launches something running as local system on the local machine or runs something on a remote machine, it creates a service, launches that service, and then that service takes care of doing whatever needs to be done. And it's always the same service. So if I do psexec -scmd, I now have something running in a non-interactive context as local system, and you can see here that its psexec service, or psexe service, is the service name. Now, a problem that we've run into and heard about a bit is the service is supposed to handle multiple requests coming in at the same time and keep track of, you know, when do I shut myself down? Because if you have two requests coming in, the service shouldn't shut down until it's done handling all the requests. But we've heard of cases where the service either lingers around or shuts down too soon or something like that. So it would be really cool if you could specify a unique service name instead. And that is exactly what -r does. So with -r, you specify the service name, and this creates both the service name and the executable name that it's going to use. So call this unique name 1. And here you see, control tooltip, there we go. See a service called unique name 1 with an executable name unique name 1. So I can create another one. Oh, and you need to be admin in order to run anything as local system. Hope that's clear. Psexec -s-r unique 2 cmd. And you'll see here two separate services handling requests from psexec. This is in psexec 2.0. I thought he was going to release it a couple months ago. He hasn't yet. Does this sound like a useful addition to you? Mark, are you in the room? He had threatened to attend my session, but must have gotten scared. Scared I would destroy his brand. And you know why? Because I am. Really, really bad. Okay. PS password is another one I want to talk about. And the reason is the book is accurate and complete, and that tool hasn't been updated. But when we were going through all the utilities, and working on the book and trying to be accurate and complete, we looked over some of the utilities and rethought some of the command line parameters and some of the functionality of some of the tools and thought, you know, this doesn't quite work well enough. PS password didn't work well enough for domain accounts, and so it has a completely different command line syntax than it used to have. PS password in the book is accurate as of now, but the correct version didn't actually get released until several months after the book came out. It's the only reason I want to mention that. New utility in the PS Tools suite that is not in the book at all, and that is PS Ping. Have any of you heard of this or used it yet? Hardly anyone. Okay, so everyone knows what ping is, right? Okay, hold on. Does anyone here know what ping is? Thank you. most boring speaker on the planet. They've all tuned out. Ping uses the ICMP protocol to query remote systems and find out if they're listening and responding. Okay? The ping.exe that comes in Windows, Mark felt was inadequate for what he needed. He's on the Azure team. He's got a lot of stuff going on with network stuff going on all the time, and he needed a better tool for that. So PSPing measures network performance to 1/100th of a millisecond resolution. It gives you standard ICMP ping functionality as well as TCP connection latency. And I'll show you the difference and why that's important in just a second, as well as TCP round trip and bandwidth exhaustion testing. And it can generate histograms. So your typical ICMP ping usage with PSPing is basically the same as what you would do with ping.exe, except it can also give you histograms. You can also specify IPv6. There's a few other things a little different. One thing that is different is the interval. You can specify zero as the interval between tests. So instead of having it ping once a second, you can have it do a series of tests one after the other after the other. TCP ping, instead of using the ICMP protocol, just tries to establish a TCP connection to a given server and port. Let me show you an example of why that's a good thing. If I do psping www.microsoft.com, what do you think will happen? The site must be down, right? Well, it might be, actually. I should have brought it up in the browser first. We'll find out in just a second. So the reason I didn't expect anything to come back from this is because most servers don't respond to ICMP. They firewall that off, right? That was fine back in the 80s, but today hardly anybody responds to that if it's locked down at all. So the syntax for TCP ping testing is you just add colon and the port number. So port 80 is the HTTP port. So what this is testing is, can I establish a connection, and how long does it take, to a given server and port? So this is obviously going to be a lot more valuable than, is it listening to ICMP, when I don't need to talk ICMP to this thing. I need to talk over port 80, TCP port 80. And so that's what TCP or PSPing can give you. Actually, let me do a little bit more demo on that one. So -i0 will say one, don't wait in between the tests. Don't have that 1 second gap. Let's do 20 of them. Okay. And how about with a histogram? What is a histogram? Okay, it gets the upper and lower bounds and figures out where did everything land within that bound. So it divides up the space evenly. This is tab delimited text, so you can manipulate this with Excel or something like that if you want. Additional features I'm not going to demo because it requires cooperation with the server on the other end. So TCP latency. How long does it take to get data back and forth? In order to do this, for the round trip testing, you need something cooperating on the remote end. And so you would run on the server psping-s, specify the network interface and the port that you want to open. Then on the client, you run psping and you point it to that destination and port with the parameters you see here, the request size. Typically, you'll want a lot of requests to get this data. And then it will test the round trip, either going up, how long does it take to upload data from the client to the server, or vice versa, using the dash R, you can tell the server, I'm ready for a test, give it a request, and it will send you data of a certain size and then measure how long does it take to get data from the server down to your client. And this will be all reported on the client. Similar to that, bandwidth usage, and what this does is it floods the channel. So you'd want to have, it'll try to max out with lots of threads communication between the client and the server, so you can test how much bandwidth do I have in this channel. So that's PS Ping. Does this affect anyone's job here? Good. Process and diagnostic utilities. By the way, I'm assuming everybody has the book already and has already read it all. Is there anybody here who hasn't read the book? Oh, a few of you. All right. Go on to O'Reilly.com or Amazon.com and download the book. And I'll give you 5 minutes to catch up with the rest of us. Appreciate it. Thanks. Is what? Is this book on Safari? That's a great question. I don't know the answer to that. I think, did someone say yes? Are you saying that because you know it to be a fact, or are you just like answering questions? Because I do that to customers all the time. I'll just, you know, whatever sounds good. It is? Okay. Apparently it is, from an authoritative source. So chapter 7 is all about the process and diagnostic utilities, including VM map, proc dump, debug view, live KDE, list DLLs, and handle. A couple things I'm going to show you with VM map. VM map is a useful utility. They're all useful utilities, every single one of them. Let me fire up. This one doesn't have to run as admin. VM map shows you, lets you pick a process, and it will show you what's in its virtual address space, the virtual memory, what is committed, and what kind of data or what kind of information is in each of these. Is it read-only? Is it read-execute? Is it writable? Is it executable and writable, which is very dangerous? Okay, so here is Explorer. One of the things that's been added is if I click here on image, so this is all executable image that's been mapped into the address space, so EXEs and DLLs primarily. It now shows you whether it has been marked for ASLR, because it is possible for different parts of the address space to be ASLR and others not. In fact, I remember a vulnerability a couple years ago where there was a DLL that was mapped in that wasn't automatically remapped to a random address, and it became something that the attackers could take advantage of because they knew it would be in a predictable location. So ASLR is now marked on a per address basis. Another new feature is this new category of memory called unusable. Now, if you open up Windows Internals, oh, by the way, how many of you think I co-authored Windows Internals? Okay, good, because I have people come up to me all the time and say, your books are awesome, I've got all of them. Really? So there's Windows Internals, which Mark Rusinovich has been co-authoring with David Solomon for a number of years, and now also with Alex Ionescu. Windows Internals is all about, here is the guts of the operating system, here is how the kernel is managed, here is how the I.O. subsystem works, here's the security subsystem. It's all just about Windows. It uses the Sysinternals tools to illustrate a lot of points, but it's all about Windows. I co-authored with Mark the Sysinternals Administrator's Reference, which is all about the Sysinternals utilities. So why did I start going off about that? Oh, yes, right, because I'm talking about unusable memory. And if you open up Windows Internals and look for a definition of that, you can find definitions for heap, shareable memory, image. All that is described in Windows Internals. Unusable isn't in there, because this is something they recently started thinking about. And it's, I think it came from the Visual Studio team needed some additional visibility into their memory usage. And here's the deal. When you use the Windows APIs to allocate memory, it always does it on a 64K boundary, which means that if you use the Windows APIs and allocate 48K, the remaining 12K will become inaccessible to the process. You won't be able to access it through any means, because the next allocation is going to be not on that where that 12K starts, but on the next 64K boundary. So you can end up with a certain amount of memory in your process that is unusable, and now VMMap will capture that and tell you what you've got there. One other relatively minor feature here, let me grab Lisa file, select process, invert mem test. VMMap will show you a history of memory allocations. So let me commit some memory. Won't free it, won't read it. Okay, allocate some memory and refresh. And let's get 3,000 more and refresh again. Okay, let me just go now to the timeline. The timeline shows you over time how much memory has been allocated. And the timeline view used to show you working set, which is basically how much of the memory is in RAM, which is not really predictable. It's not something that the process really has direct control over, because the amount of working set you have is affected by other processes that push your stuff out. So now it shows committed bytes. So commit usage rather than working set, which is a lot more useful and a lot more predictable. The tool that got the most updating, the most love and attention, Process Explorer got a bunch of updates, but nothing like procdump. It is now up to three major updates. Version 6.0 just came out this week. Is Andrew Richards in the room? Andrew's in the room. Everyone, please applaud for Andrew. Andrew, stand up. Andrew would not be insulted if I said he is an absolute uber geek, right? He is a senior geek, senior escalation engineer, now with the Windows team, formerly with the Exchange team. He doesn't want me to tell anybody that he used to work Exchange because he wants to put that behind him. But if you have any questions about Exchange, I'll give you his private home number and you can call him up. Andrew has done a ton of work working on procdump and putting new features into it because he needs it. He uses it all the time. So here's procdump before Andrew got his hands on it. You'd been working on it by this point too, I think. But you can see it's only got a little bit of functionality. It's fairly primitive as tools go, right? Let me back up a second. Procdump, what procdump is about is it can capture a user mode dump file for a process. What does that mean? A dump file captures the state at a given point in time of that process. What were the contents of the CPU registers, what threads were running, and what memory was in the stacks belonging to each of those threads, what was in memory. Okay, you can take that file and analyze it on that machine, or take it to a completely different machine and figure out what was going on in this process at the time that this happened. What code was it executing when this happened? And what procdump will let you do is you can set a bunch of different criteria to say, when this happens, I want to capture a dump of that file without killing the process, but just at this point in time, capture the state of the file or of the process so that I can analyze it at a later time. And as I'm saying here, there's not a whole lot here. You got CPU, you got memory, you've got performance counter thresholds. Of course, anybody could do that, right? He didn't give me the finger, did you? Okay. I'm kidding, I can't see that far. Here is version 6, which just came out this week. Tons of new functionality. The stuff that's changed since, some of what's changed, the dash E option says capture a dump when an exception is raised within the process. What's new, that's been there for since forever, or for a very, very long time. What it can do now that it couldn't do when the book came out is it can also capture on managed exceptions, .NET code exceptions, which it couldn't do before. Dash F lets you filter, only capture a dump if an exception of this type, this name, comes in. And as of this week, there's a new feature that allows you to specify more than one name to the filter. Dash G says if it's a managed app, don't worry about the managed exceptions, only look for the native exceptions. Dash L says if the process is producing any diagnostic debug output, like the stuff you would see in a debugger or in debug view by Sysinternals, which I'll talk about in a second, procdump can now capture that as well. Dash X has been there for a long time. It allows you to use procdump to start a process. So if you need to see what's going on from the time the process starts moving forward, you can use dash X to specify, launch this program and monitor everything it does. What's different, a couple things are different. One is the order of the command line parameters have changed since the book came out to make it easier to have some automated scenarios around being able to handle command line parameters on a more dynamic basis. It can also be used to launch modern Windows runtime applications. And this is a really cool feature. Dash I lets you register procdump as the just-in-time debugger. So if a process crashes, you can set it up so that procdump will automatically launch, grab a hold of that process, and capture a dump according to however you want to configure it. Because one of the things procdump can do is it can create something called a mini plus dump file, which is not as big as a full dump, but much more useful than just a regular mini dump. So procdump can allow, it also lets you specify, put it in this directory, please, so you don't have to go hunting for wherever it may have dropped the dump files. There have been options for a long time to say, capture a dump if CPU usage exceeds a threshold, if memory commit exceeds a threshold, or if a performance counter threshold exceeds a particular level. With dash CL, ML, and PL, now you can say, capture a dump if the threshold goes below a certain level. So it may be perfectly normal for your process to consume 75% of the CPU, and it's abnormal for it to drop below, say, 50. So with dash CL, you can now say, if it drops below that, capture a dump. Another feature just added this week in version 6.0, you can always specify procdump, specify the process name or the process ID. Now you can also specify a service by name. So you specify the service name and it'll automatically figure out what process is that service running in and attach to it. And like I also said, you can specify more than one filter. I'm going to come back to this because I do want to do a little bit of demo of procdump. Actually, how much time do I have? I've got 20 minutes and I have to do procdump. Must. I mean, three major revisions, I have to show something. Okay. Oh, yes, I must. Yeah, I've got something very important I need to show you. You will love this. So there are the command line options. There's also procdump slash questions dash E to see a bunch of sample command lines. That's pretty useful. But I really, really need to show you this thing. Let me see. Let me set this up. First, I need to have process monitor running. Reset that filter. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and add these events here, these profiling events, are not normally shown. And what happens is every second, Procmon will generate an event, an artificial event, showing the state, how much CPU has been consumed by the process over its lifetime. I'm going to hide those explicitly because I need to show you this. So let's say I've got this test program here, and I'm going to capture a dump when it exceeds a certain threshold. So let's say CPU goes over 50% for this particular process. And it's called vertmem. The name of the process is vertmemtest64. I think that's all I needed to do. Actually, I've got multiple CPUs, so let me do that. Okay, so it is now attached itself to vertmemtest64.exe, and if the CPU threshold exceeds 50% of a single core, this is a multi-core machine, it will write to this location. I'm going to run the CPU hog, and you can see here a couple things. CPU is going up, and you can see proc dump is seeing. Now, by default, it's only going to capture a dump if it runs for 10 seconds. Ah, it hit the 10 second. I was going to try to cut it off so it wouldn't actually write a dump file, because you can get information about this through proc dump without actually even having to write a dump file. Because one of the things that has been in Procmon for a long time is the ability to send it artificial events of your own, debug output sent to Procmon, and have it show up in the stream. Let's take a look at that. So what I'm going to do is filter on two processes. The vertmem test that was generating the events. And I'm going to go into the process tree and also show proc dump, because it is generating these debug events. See this stuff here? That is the exact same output that was appearing on the console. It is now part of the Procmon trace. So now you can go back through here and see, okay, it tried to create this file, or open this file, vertmemtest.log, and then the CPU went up. I think this is phenomenal. Do you remember back in the days when FileMon and RegMon were separate programs? Right? And you've got, here's all my file system events, here's all my registry events. How do you correlate them? There wasn't a way to do it. And then Procmon finally came along, and it's like, hey, I've got all of them in one place. Now you can add to that anything that ProcDump can monitor. You can add that now to your Procmon trace. Exceptions, performance counter threshold being exceeded, CPU spinning, you know, hung processes, whatever. Anything that ProcDump can monitor and will output to the console will now appear in the Procmon trace. One feature was added just this week also with version 6. You can see the exceptions show up in the stream, and now with version 6 it will show additional message text, not just the name of the exception like file not found exception, but the text that went along with it, which is very useful for scripting, because JavaScript, when it generates an exception, it is always the same exception. It doesn't give you any information. But now, with version 6.0, you get all that additional information, and now you can have it show up in Procmon. Good? I hate to do this, but I'm going to ask for if you could all stand up and give Andrew a standing ovation for that. Just turn and face back that way and give him a standing ovation. Okay, one thing I want to point out about Debug View, the book is accurate and remains pretty much complete. One of the things that changed in it, though, around the time of the book, is we were trying to figure out, how do we describe this thing with the agent, or no, what was it, the client and the server. And the definition of client and server back when Mark wrote this back in the 90s, didn't really make sense anymore. And so we changed it to agent and viewer, okay, which makes a little more sense. So it didn't bump up the major version because it wasn't any really new functionality. But the command line syntax had to change because the naming had changed so much. So the book is accurate and complete, but you may want to, be aware of this. There's also command line options in there to capture specific, to enable capturing of specific types of output. LiveKD. LiveKD is a Sysinternals utility that, oh, they're all Sysinternals utilities, my goodness. Yeah. So LiveKD is one that allows you to capture a snapshot of kernel memory on your box and then view that snapshot using a kernel mode debugger. So you can analyze kernel mode memory without having to boot into debug mode. Okay. One of the things that changed is it was possible before to capture to write that that snapshot to memory with the, I believe it was the dash O option. You could run LiveKD dash O and name a file. It would just run, capture a snapshot, and write it to the disk. The problem with it was that while it was doing that, while it was writing kernel memory was continuing to change. So you wouldn't end up with a consistent point in time snapshot. With dash M, it takes advantage of new features in Windows that allow it to capture a true, just moment in time, consistent snapshot. So that can be very useful. It adds support for Windows 8 and for newer Intel processors that have these additional options. List DLLs now allows you to capture more information about the DLLs in a process. And handle. Handle got no updates at all. But every time the Process Explorer kernel mode driver gets updated, handle has to get updated too because it uses the same one. SigCheck is one of the security utilities. It is used for looking at digital signatures on files. Dash I now reports much more detailed certificate information. Actually, I think I've got screenshots of some of these, so let me just go ahead to those. Yes, so here is SigCheck 170. And what it would show you, if you did dash I, it would show you the subject name of the signing certificate and the certificate, the issuing certificates in the signing chain. When Stuxnet and Flame started really abusing valid signing certificates, Mark added a bunch of additional stuff. So SigCheck, as of 1.9, actually, I think it was earlier than this, dash I now shows a ton of information about the certificates and all the certificates in the signing chain, as well as countersigning signatures, such as the timestamp. And actually, this is now no longer completely up to date because as of this week, SigCheck version 1.92 is the current version. Another recent change is SigCheck for unsigned files. It would just show you the file date according to the file system. Problem with that is that the file system is not always going to be very reliable. It's very easy for the date to get messed up on a file, right? You download it from the internet, you get it off of a different file system, and you end up with the current date instead of the date that it was actually created. So, for executable files, it now shows the link date. The link date is embedded within portable executable files, and it will show you that date instead. That date can still be falsified, but not by accident. So this can be a lot more useful if you're trying to figure out when was this executable actually created. SigCheck can now report that for you. BG Info. How many of you use BG Info? How many of you use it on Windows 8? One. And what does it tell you you're running? When it shows you the operating system. The IP, so they don't use it to show the operating system. So if you look at, if it reports the operating system as Windows NT 6.2. Okay, so there is one in the works that will report the marketing name, Windows 8, instead of 6.2. But it's not out yet. Desktops has been updated to work with Windows 8. The previous version was completely broken by the new UI model. Zoomit Zoom it. I was doing a presentation yesterday, and my co-presenter did not use Zoom it, which annoyed the audience. Actually asked, can you please use Zoom it? And he said, I don't know how. And I couldn't believe I was on the same stage with a guy who didn't know how to use it. Anyway, very quickly, a couple new changes here. You can set the initial level of magnification. You can animate the zoom in and out. So by default, it will go zoom and then zoom back out, which hurts when you're over an RDP connection. So you can turn that off so it just magnifies right away and reverts right away without the animation. Perhaps the most useful feature is this. Oh, I can't use zoom it when I've got the dialog open. That's interesting. Hopefully you can see this. Run zoom it when Windows starts. So I always put zoom it in the start menu or the run key or something like that. Now there's a checkbox within zoom it to do that. So you can just check that box, and whenever you log in, zoom it will start right up for you. Saves you the trouble of dropping it in the run key or wherever. Strings, minor change to strings. I want to get to disk usage because this will let me show you something that will be worth the price of admission to TechEd for you. I'm quite certain of this. I know this will be a big applause line when I show this. Okay, so DU is a utility that, similar to the Unix version, shows you here's the disk usage from this directory and below, or from, you know, the top level and below. Nothing really special there. It is. It does more than just go through and count everything, because it also takes into account things like hard links, where you have multiple names that actually point to the same content, so you don't want to count that multiple times. It recognizes a lot of the different ways that the NTFS file system will allow you to reuse portions of the hard drive. But let me see here. Let me go down to program files, and I'll do du dot, and there's the legal agreement. So you go through, and I should have done this earlier to bring that stuff into the cache. Some of the new features that have been added include CSV output. And then the CSV output got changed and updated with a lot more useful stuff. Maybe I should have picked a smaller directory. Yep, I'm going to go to a subdirectory of this. That's better. Okay, so du dash v will give you a list of here's how much content in megabytes and the directory name. And then you can try to grab that and sort it. But it's a lot more useful if you get that into a CSV format. So du dash c dot dash v dot. Okay, now that's a CSV. Now you can do some more interesting stuff with that. But even newer than that, make it dash CT, and it does tab delimited. Now, why is that good? And here's where you're going to have the price of admission covered. I'm going to pipe that into a utility called Clip. How many of you have heard of Clip before? Okay, good, not many of you. You're going to love this, right? So Clip is a utility. It's one of those really weird things, because it's a command line utility that's really useful that isn't from Sysinternals. It's actually part of Windows. And what it does is it takes whatever comes in through standard input, it copies it to the clipboard. So you saw the output that just went through. I'm now going to pipe that into Clip. And now I'm going to go into Excel, which likes tab delimited more than it likes comma delimited for some reason. Filter, auto size. How's that? So the comma delimited output, the CSV output now includes a lot more information, including not just how much data is in that directory and below, but how many directories, how many files are in the current directory, what is the size just in the current directory, and the number of files overall from here down. So a lot more useful information. So, you know, finding which directory actually has all the stuff, it's now easier to find that. You didn't like Clip that much? Clip was pretty good, right? How many of you are going to use that every day now? I use it all the time. Contig. How many of you use Contig? Yeah, me neither. Okay. Click. Who is? Everyone knows what who is, right? It tells you what the registration is for the domain. Dash V was added, which the way who is works is it contacts a first level who is server.net.com, something like that, which gives you the referrals of here's where that's registered. Okay, so dash V will now tell you the intermediate information that comes from the first level server. And if you want to do something really fun, do who is dash V Microsoft.com. And look for all the domain names that have Microsoft.com in them. I can't do it here because it would cost me my job. There's a lot of domains out there that are taking the name Microsoft in vain. I'll just leave it at that. You can do that if you want. Don't do it at work unless you don't work with people around you. That's all I'll say about it. Okay, I've got a few minutes left. Actually, this is the last session, isn't it? So we could stay here for hours if we want to. We don't have any place else to go. Everybody good? We're all staying, right? No, lock the doors. Nobody needs to leave now. Okay, I'll try to get through this very quickly. RU is a new utility, brand new utility, just came out in March. Actually, I have a slide coming up about that in just a second, so let me skip ahead and just talk about RAMMAP really quickly. And just point out, RAMMAP is a utility that shows you the content of physical RAM and what processes own what parts and how much of it belongs to drivers and things like that. The thing that is new is the command line options. You can now specify, you can run RAMMAP and have it automatically save all the content to a RAMMAP file. And you can also open a RAMMAP file from the command line now. It used to be you'd have to open up the thing and then manually do a save. Now you can do it on the command line. One thing to note is if you capture a 32-bit, or if you capture RAMMAP data on a 32-bit system, and then you want to look at it on a 64-bit system, you need to use the dash run 32 option because it uses a different file format for 64 and 32-bit captures. Core info will report tons of information about all the CPU capabilities, and tons more have been added. I'll just leave it at that, and we'll jump over to RU, which brand new, came out March 27th. It is identical in syntax to DU for disk usage. This is now register usage. So you can find the keys in your registry where things have gotten bloated up. Now, this is not as useful every day as DU, but I do know of cases that have been solved because they found that there was a lot of data accumulating in some parts of the registry. And so now we have a tool that makes it really easy to find that stuff. And again, the syntax is exactly the same. You have dash C for CSV, where it will show you, you know, all the intermediate data, and dash CT for tab delimited. Okay, so if you're interested in the Sysinternals primers from the past and you like to reminisce, or, you know, how many of you have been to one of the Sysinternals primers before? Okay, so I'm glad someone wanted to actually come back and see another. That's encouraging. But the previous ones are available on Channel 9. For more information about Sysinternals, there is the website, the blog. I do recommend register for feeds from the blog, because whenever a new tool is updated or any new tool comes out, any announcements about Sysinternals go through the blog. So you would have known already this week, if you were subscribing to that feed, that 5 tools were updated this week. Mark Rasinovich's blog is very good. The Windows Sysinternals Administrator's Reference is awesome. I also have a blog. I won't compare it to Mark's because it's better than his. Andrew has a blog, and he also is the star of Defrag Tools. It's a live show that appears every Monday. How many minutes? An hour? I can't hear that far. Half an hour, thank you. Really cool, geeky, detailed debugging, diagnostic, troubleshooting stuff. It's very worthwhile to go check that out. Andrew also has an article in MSDN Magazine about writing a plugin where you can extend procdump yourself. Related sessions, well, they're all over now. But you can go and see the recordings if you like. Oh, I don't know what these slides are. So these are the ones they put in. That looks nice. Click. Complete an evaluation. Yes, so very important. If you enjoyed the session, please go fill out an evaluation. If you didn't, please come talk to me about it instead. Thank you. Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks for coming to TechEd. Oh, I have t-shirts.